Hi, good afternoon. Welcome to our Power of the Word webcast. This is Paul from Faith Baptist Church South Metro in Paranaque City. Thanks for joining. Today we're going to talk about overcoming steps, practical steps for overcoming crisis in our life. You know, sooner or later we all face crisis, and maybe some of you don't have a crisis right now, but just wait. Crisis is inevitable. Sooner or later we face it. Someone said for a crisis to be a real crisis, it must be a situation where you are hopeless and helpless and there is no human help. And I think that's a good definition for a crisis, because most of the time we say we have crisis, but actually we can still do something. In the case of the Jews, the Exodus generation, they had nowhere to go and they were boxed in. God led them to a place where they can't do anything. They can escape anywhere. But that was a test, and we looked at that last week. So we'll continue that story here and learn more principles. Today, I'm going to show you some practical ways you can overcome crisis in your life. But before we do that, let's bow for prayer. Ask God to give us guidance and understanding of His Word. Thank you, Father, for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to once again dig into your word, look at the story here in the book of Exodus, and learn some valuable spiritual lessons from this crisis, Lord. I pray that God, the Holy Spirit, might challenge each one, help us to concentrate and apply your word. This is a prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, there is a right way and a wrong way to handle crisis and to face crisis in our life. That was shown with Moses there and the Jews. The Jews panicked. They fell apart. Some of them wanted to go back to Egypt. But you know, Moses, there were over 2 million people. And at the edge of the sea, there was only one spiritually strong and mature believer, and that is Moses, who was capable of trusting God, who was able to trust God in a hopeless situation. Now, so let's look at a little bit of review from what we had last week. Okay, it's good to refresh. So the Jews were leaving Egypt for 430 years. This is based on God's plan. They have a promised land waiting for them, the land of Canaan, and this is the greatest blessing they have as a nation, because God was trying to really make them a nation to represent himself on earth. That is the purpose of the Jewish nation. Remember that. So it was now time for God to bring out his chosen people and bring them to the land of Canaan. And God chose a leader, Moses. Maybe in the future we'll study Moses, the greatest leader in the Old Testament. So Pharaoh had allowed the people to leave, but he quickly changed his mind and decided he would pursue them with his entire army in order to kill them. You know, evil leaders are like that. When they are saturated with arrogance and evil in their soul, they always inflict untold suffering to scores and scores of people. And this is what the Pharaoh intended to do for the Jews. And as we know already, God selected the route in order to test them. They were boxed in, but it was an opportunity to trust God. You know, when you face a crisis, it can either make or break you. And you have the greatest opportunity to give glory to God. Okay, when you face a hopeless situation, it's a situation where God's glory is at stake, where you can really grow when you apply His word and believe Him to solve this crisis. You're gonna grow by leaps and bounds in your relationship with God when you overcome crisis by the use of the word of God, which we're going to see in a while. Okay, so Moses was alone. He was the only one, but only one mature believer can change the tide. That is historical impact. It just took one guy, a strong mature believer, to change the tide. And God honored him. Okay, let's look at a few principles as part of our review. God led the Jews to a healthy situation to test their faith. It was not to destroy them. God was not intending to destroy them. He has a great plan for them, because he wanted to show his power to these people, who and what he is. The test was necessary for their spiritual growth as their capacity for the blessing of the promised land. You gotta have capacity for what God has in store for you. You gotta have a mature capacity, and the test will help them become spiritually mature when they apply, but they did not. Okay? Without personal love for God, we possess no capacity for divine blessings. The test was intended for them to appreciate God when God eventually solves the crisis, comes in and uses his power. But no, they failed. So we need tests to develop capacity, okay? I mean, just think about that statement. The Jews failed the test because they failed to believe God and believe God's promises. Moses, on the other hand, passed the test because he trusted in God and the promise of God. So as I said, it only takes one strong, mature believer to turn the tide of historical crisis. If you keep on learning God's word, if you keep on listening and digging in the word of God, and you become a strong, mature believer, God is going to use you in historical crisis. And this is what's happened to Moses. Okay, for our lesson today, let's resume reading the Bible in the book of Exodus. We'll continue the story. Let's begin in verse 21. We are in Exodus chapter 14, verse 21. Let's see what happens next. Then Moses, okay, stretched out his hand. You know, they already panicked. They were crying. They were blaming Moses. The army of Pharaoh is approaching. The soldiers are approaching. They are armed to the teeth. They have chariots. And while the people panic, God told Moses, stretch out your hand. And this is Moses obeying here. Then Moses stretched out his hand, he was holding the rod, over the sea. And the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night. In other words, this was the whole night. God parted the Red Sea so they could cross, and made the sea into a dry land, and the waters were divided. Verse 22, so the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, and the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Now someone computed, because I do research on these verses, someone computed that how did they pass? How long was the column? Okay, how wide was the column and how long? You know, 2 million people plus their animals and all of that. It's interesting. But what the Bible says is they were able to cross, all of them, to the other side of the shore. So what happened after they crossed? Verse 28, let's jump there. Verse 28, then the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen, all the army of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. Not much as one of them remained. In other words, the Bible says every one of them who chased the Jews, they were killed. They drowned. But the children of Israel had walked on dry ground in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall to them on the right hand and on their left. Verse 30, so the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. Wow, it is the Lord who saved us. It is the Lord who saved us. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Wala lang, mga katawan nila, naglulutangan dyan. Verse 31, thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord hath done in Egypt. So the people feared, and the word fear there means respect, awe, reverential fear. They feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Let's look at a few lessons here. Number one, I want to talk about the grace lesson here. In other words, please don't miss the grace aspect of this story. God still parted the sea, even though the Jews failed to trust him. The Jews totally failed. There was only one believer who trusted God. Yet God still, in spite of their unbelief, delivered them. Because here's a principle, God's grace depends on who and what he is, and not on who and what we are. 2 Timothy 2:13 says, if we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. You know, how many times have we failed our crisis? How many times have we made bad decisions in our life? How many times have we rejected God's word and God's promises and fell apart in crisis? And yet I can tell you, you are still alive today. You're watching here. God still provided for you. God still protected you. And folks, listen, that is called grace. Because grace is the favor of God that depends entirely on His character. Not on our character, His character. Remember that, okay? That's the concept of grace. That is undeserved favor from God. We never earn or deserve anything that God does for us. Lesson number two, Moses believed God's promise before the miracle occurred. There's a difference. The Jews believed and respected or feared God after they saw the miracle of the Red Sea, after they were delivered. So principle here, faith is believing when you can't see. That's the definition of faith, di ba? Hindi mo pa nakita, but you believe God. You can't see God. But you believe in Him. He is real to you. And God can only be real to you when you have God's word in your soul. Let's go back here. There's a difference, big difference, between believing God before He performs a miracle and believing Him because you saw the miracle. It's a big difference. Number three, faith comes, the Bible says, faith comes by hearing and hearing of the word of God. Romans 10:13. And therefore, today, let's look at some steps, very practical steps, on how we can have victory over disaster. How we face crisis with inner happiness and peace and tranquility. It's possible. Yes. Maybe, you know, how can I have peace if I have just 1 year to live or a few months to live? I have cancer. How can I have peace when I have just lost my job or my business? How can I have peace when, you know, my loved one just died? How can these people in Ukraine have peace when there are missiles bombarding them every single day by the hour? Well, you have to go back to God. You have to go back to His word. What does He say? So, let's look at some steps here, very practical. The first thing you need to do, we all need to do, is to learn the promises of God. Learn the promises of God, ideally before the crisis. Because it's too late when you try to learn, you know, you already have a crisis and then you are trying to search the Bible for, well, where is that promise? We must learn God's word and promises ahead of time. There are 7,000 promises in the Bible for us to claim. There's treasure in the Bible and that the promises. Let's look at a few promises, okay? For example, Romans 8:28. What does the Bible say? What does this promise say? And we know. See, you have to know. The Bible always emphasizes knowledge of God, His word, His promises. We know. We have confidence. We are assured that all things work together for good to those who love God. Actually, the grammatical structure here in the Greek, according to scholars, is that all things don't work together. It's God who works. So God is the subject. God is the one who works all things. The word all things, the phrase all things, there refer to our problems, our adversities, our crisis, our suffering, our pain. God can work all things together. But you need, it's qualified. But those who love God, you got to love God. To those who are called according to His purpose. Now, what does that mean to you? If you are in a crisis right now, if you have some serious problems in your life right now, Think of this. God deliberately, intentionally allowed that in your life in order to motivate you to trust Him, to learn His promise, and to trust Him, and to put the matter in His hand. Got that? Let's go to a second promise here. No, we cannot place here all the promises, but I've just selected a few. For example, Psalm 23:4a. This is David. David We had that series, you know, for several months. I hope you remember. This is what it says here in Psalm 23:4a. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And he many times, death stared David in the face. When he faced Goliath, he was chased by King Saul, his enemies. But you know, no matter how many times you face death, you will only die if it's God's time for you to die. So he says here, I will fear no evil. You cannot fear death if you are a child of God. Have you believed in Christ? Have you accepted Him as your personal Savior? Then the Bible says you are a child of God. If you are a child of God through faith in Him, you should not fear death, because the moment that you die, 1 second later, you're face to face with God in heaven. That's what the Bible says. That's why Paul says in Philippians 1:21, for me, living is Christ. Because he has accepted Christ and he is occupied with Christ as his Savior. Likewise, dying is gain or profit. So no fear of death. This is one of the most unsettling things to many people. The fear of dying or death. Here's what the promise says. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. The King James says, for thou art with me. God is with you. In fact, if you live in the church age, which we are right now, we're living in the church age, God is in us. There is indwelling of God in you. Jesus Christ lives in you. The Holy Spirit lives in you. And wherever you go, God is in you. So that promise alone will remove fear of death in your life. Another promise here, this is by Jesus Christ himself. Before he left, this was before he was crucified. He walked here on the earth during the first Advent. John 16:33. The Bible says, these things, Jesus is speaking here, I have spoken to you. You see, these things refers to right now to the Bible, to the Word of God. This is the Word of Jesus Christ. When Jesus Christ was here on earth, he taught the disciples his promises, his doctrines, his words, his principles, the truths. So he says, these things have I spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. You can only have peace, tranquility, serenity in Jesus Christ. He is the only source of peace in your life. You can't find peace anywhere, real peace. So he says, in the world, you will have tribulation. And the Greek word there means pressure. We looked at that last time. Tribulation, crisis, adversity, difficulty, suffering, pain, tribulation, troubles. He says, but be of good cheer. Be happy. The word be of good, the phrase be of good cheer means be happy. You can still, you know that only in Christianity can you have inner happiness in spite of adversity and crisis. Because he says, I have overcome the world. The world inflicted tremendous pain and adversity on the person and the humanity of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ experienced suffering and agony that we will never, ever know. Both physical, psychological, spiritual. And yet he says, I have overcome the world. So what a promise. Do you have a crisis today? You can have peace according to this promise. You can have inner peace. Happiness. That's the first step you have to learn. I just gave you a few examples. The second step that you need to do is to mix the promises of God that you learn with faith. Because it's possible that you memorize these promises and it's only an academic knowledge. is not really metabolized in your soul. So you have to mix it with your faith. You believe the promises, learn it, know it, believe it. Let's look at the passage in the book of Hebrews 3, verses 15 to 19. This is talking about the Jews, the same Jews that we talked about earlier. But this is now the New Testament, and the writer of Hebrews talks about them. He says, while it is said, verse 9-15, today if you will hear his voice, which is not amount to the word of God, the Bible, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, the Meribah, the complaining Jews. They were rebelled against God. They were complaining for 40 years. That's what it means here. For who having heard rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Okay, these are the guys. Okay, now with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? In other words, because of the continuous rejection of God, as promises his word, rejection of the plan of God, these Jews died in the wilderness. 18, unto whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest? But to those who did not obey or believe. So we see, verse 19, that they, these Jews in the past, could not enter in the rest of God because of unbelief. What they say? There is a place of rest in the Christian life. Maybe there is no rest in your life. You are filled with anxiety every day. You are filled with stress every day. But I'm here to tell you there is rest in God and His Word. And there's a place of rest. But you have to remove unbelief. Because it continues in Hebrews 4, 1 and 2. See? Therefore, sabi ng author, since a promise remains of entering His rest, there's a promise that you can enter a place of rest. You know, this is mental rest, okay? Let us fear that any of you seem to have come short of it. Now, there's fear is a sin, but in this case, you should fear that you will miss applying. You will miss the rest that God provides, the peace, the tranquility, the joy that God provides, because you don't mix the promises of God with faith. It says there, verse 2, for indeed the gospel or the good news or the promises was preached to us as well as to them, the Israelites. But the word which they heard did not profit them, the Jews of the Exodus, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. In other words, they heard Bible teaching, they heard Moses and Aaron teach them, but they did not believe. They did not mix the word with their faith. So it's very important. You got to believe. Learn the promises ahead of time. Believe the promises so that it becomes metabolized and part of your soul that you can use, you're ready to use when the crisis comes in your life. The third step is to claim the promise. See, first learn, believe, then claim. Those are just very simple practical steps that when you use these steps in any situation, in any problem, you will experience God's joy, God's rest, God's peace. That's what the Bible says. Claiming the promises in crisis means application when the crisis comes. This produces rest, peace, tranquility, and inner happiness during the crisis. Okay, let me repeat that. Just summarize it. How do you face a crisis? Now, maybe it's too late for you, but it's easy to open the Bibles, go to your concordance, go to the internet, promises for crisis, you type there, it will show you, and then memorize that promise, understand that, because promises are really, folks, they are capsulized principles. Yung short lang sila. We're not talking about here the doctrine, Bible doctrine, that's long doctrine, heavy doctrine. We're talking here about simple promises. What time I am afraid, I will trust you. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. Fear not thou, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, I am your God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. These are all short capsulized principle that will help you in times of crisis so that you can avoid panic and falling apart when the crisis hits you. You got that? Very important. So let's conclude this lesson today. First of all, believing God in the face of a crisis before He provides the solution is better than believing Him after He demonstrates His power to solve your crisis. Listen, if you believe God before He provides a solution for you, that's what you call faith resting in God. That's a technique. I'm teaching you a technique here, a practical technique. And when you do that, you increase, listen, you increase your appreciation of God, your love for God, your occupation with Christ. So trust God before He shows His power. Maybe you are in the middle of a crisis. Trust God. Number two, passing the crisis test increases your spiritual strength. You become stronger. You create spiritual muscles when you apply God's word every time you face a stressful situation, adversity, difficulty, disasters in your life. That's number one. It advances your spiritual growth. It accelerates your occupation with Jesus Christ. You know, in the book of James 1:12, it says there that when we have trials, it increases our love for Christ when we trust Him. Because when we have nowhere to go, there's pain, there's pressure, and we trust Jesus Christ, our love for Him increases. Then number three, crisis preparation for you as a believer involves the daily discipline of taking in God's word. Many, many people are not prepared for anything in life. They're not prepared for Christ. They're not even prepared for normal times. Can't even cope with the normal routines of life. How can you cope with a crisis if you can't even cope with the normal pressures of life? What if war comes to the Philippines? What if some nation invades us? That's a crisis. That's adversity. What if your doctor tells you you have only a few months to live, your stage 4 cancer or whatever? You got to prepare ahead of time. But if you're in that situation right now, just stay with the Word of God. Keep listening. Keep learning God's Word. Because God's Word is the solution to the crisis of life. So we have to transfer. See, the thing is, we have to transfer the promises from this book into our souls. And those promises have to become part of our thinking, part of our soul, so that we are ready when crisis comes. And God in His grace will never give us a crisis that will overburden us, that will destroy us. He will always give us a test that we are potentially capable of overcoming. It's difficult to realize that when we have crisis, it's actually the love of God that's expressing it, expressing for us. Because He wants us to grow. He wants us to mature, or we have capacity for the blessings that He has in store for us. If you have not accepted Christ as your Savior, this is the time for you to accept Him. He died for you on the cross of Calvary. And the Bible says, he that believeth on Him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed on the name of the only begotten Son of God. You can make that decision right now as we end this Bible study. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Thank you, Father, for your word today. May God, the Holy Spirit, touch our hearts, make the right decisions with regards to our priorities, learning your promises, believing your promises, and applying your promises in times of our crisis, adversities, and land, so that we can glorify you with our life on earth. Thank you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for watching. See you next Sunday.